when I built my first Minecraft city, and it became big enough to justify a railway system, I went for the most obvious station design. The player enters the cart and pushes a button to go forward. A detector allows any occupied cart to leave the station. The empty ones are filtered out and destroyed. Easy so far. What if there's no cart in the bay? The button could be hooked up to both the powered rail and a dispenser, which would also recycle any discarded cart. But there's a problem. What if a cart is coming from the previous station? A simple detector rail will send away any cart sitting in the bay. That was my initial design, and it worked, in ideal situations. But nobody's perfect, and machines must be held above human standards. That's the cold, hard truth. Let's go through it one more time. When you press the button, you make the cart go forward and dispense a new one. For the sake of simplicity, this action is called go dispense. Now, a number of things could happen. The dispenser might be empty, unable to provide a new cart, or the detector is not triggered and the cart goes back to the dispenser. When a cart is coming from the previous station, the machine makes any cart in the bay move forward without dispensing a new one. This action is called just go. That's it. These are the only two scenarios, right? Well, what if you press the button, go dispense, but at the same time there's another cart right behind you? Depending on how the two events intersect, the outcome can be slightly inconvenient or disastrous. Not to mention that an empty cart moves slower than an occupied one. What if you press the button? Then press it again, and again and again. This undocumented feature might interfere with normal operations. Inputs from the button can be easily restricted with an anti-spam, and the signal generated by the detector rail could split in two. One towards the bay, as go, and one as a gatekeeper for the dispenser. So in most cases, the arriving cart can cut the dispense line for a second and freely drop down to an empty, unpowered bay. The last scenario is that more than one cart is moving towards the station. If properly distanced, the go signal should send the carts on the way and leave the last one on the bay. Speaking of spamming and jamming, the user accessible loader is the weakest link, unless a filter is put in place, and a sloping dispenser rail should reject any cart fed from above. Surely, these are all nice upgrades, but we still haven't explored the biggest factor in user experience. Laziness, comfort. Say you have to go through 5 stations in your route. Instead of pressing a button each time, the departure can be automatically scheduled. First, we need something that can keep time, and the best way to do it is by using the twin hoppers. Hoppers can hold the items in a chain when powered by redstone, and based on their content, can output a signal through a comparator. So we should attach a toggleable component, which can change the flow between the two hoppers. This component is usually an ArisaMetro latch, which is made of 2 NOR gates, each with at least 1 input and 1 output. Here's how it works. The hopper A, Anna, powered by the torch, has all the items. The other B, Barbara, has none. The latch is toggled, and the hoppers change state, allowing the items to flow from Anna to Barbara. When all the items have been transferred to Barbara, the now empty-handed Anna sends an inverted pulse to the latch, resetting it. The hoppers revert to their previous state, and the items go from Barbara back to Anna. That's what the timer does on its own. In the station, we can use the hopper outputs to our advantage. Barbara holds at least 1 item during the whole cycle, and its redstone output is exploded for 2 very important tasks: blocking external inputs to the timer, making it spam-proof, and cutting the redstone line to the dispenser. So if you're impatient and press the button while waiting, you'll only send a go signal, and Anna, while it's empty for a split second, will send a go dispense pulse which bypasses the block imposed by Barbara. Inputs from the button pass through an anti-spam as well, with Barbara blocking access to the go dispense line. The two scenarios have changed. When you push the button, the cart goes forward and a new one is provided. The moving cart can either go to the next station or back to the dispenser, or the dispenser might be empty, just like before. But in addition, the button is disabled until the go dispense cycle is complete. Meanwhile, arrivals will send a go signal and start a timer, which will prevent any cart from being dispensed while it's running. Then it will send a typical go dispense signal, then the timer will expire. Now that all user actions are regulated, the machine is pretty much spam-proof, and it's finally ready to... Alright, maybe it's not flawless. What's more important is retrofitting the actual facilities. No easy task. One of them even sits dangerously close to a ravine, which can't be filled in because there's a restaurant inside. Oh. So, I copied the machine and worked through 8 more iterations. I would like to show you some of them. But before we get on with the show, let me interject. You're about to witness a personal journey in a vessel of severely limited intelligence. Learning is frustrating. I flat out refuse to watch any tutorials, mostly out of fear of being unoriginal. In fact, most of what I know about station tech comes from observation rather than methodical study. However, the risk of plagiarism is not nullified by ignorance. The following machines, from an engineering standpoint, may look a little familiar, because the simplest and most functional design is the product of a logical conclusion. A widespread adoption is proof of versatility. Figuring out what to do in the first place and how to implement it is another thing. It only took me the better part of a decade. So if a doofus like me can build a minecart station, so can you. Whew. Here we go. The first issue I wanted to address was the inability to access the base without walking over the tracks, and the position of the base themselves, hidden by the huge detectors. There just wasn't a clear path to follow. The only two sensible options are to designate a walkable area in the middle or the sides. Another problem was purely visual, but solving it wound up dramatically affecting usability. Look at this overhead view of the original station. Can I just say it? This thing is ugly. Symmetry is an afterthought at best. There's lots of wasted, inaccessible space. And what is this bulge? Okay, to make people feel at ease if they're trapped. Whatever. The jankiness doesn't end there. In the other machine, the collector goes to the right side of the bay, a space-saving measure that carries one unforgivable flaw. There aren't many choices. You either mirror or rotate, and then how do you access the other side without over-engineered passageways? Visualizing a minecart station seems easy until you have to consider where to put the redstone. That's when it came natural to break it up into modules. Bay, detector, dispenser, collector, loader. The challenge was to move them around while keeping them connected, preferably with bays accessible from the sides, and the final result smaller than the original. At the end, everything lined up, with the two bays at the extremes, followed by the detectors and a single collector with a loader on the right side, one for each dispenser located at roughly the same position as before. Get ready for the ultimate transport revolution. A game-changing bilateral design opens multiple connections through a wide, uncluttered passage. The loader has a premium feel with automated opening, and the unified collector is now the safest in the industry. But everybody knows the real magic is under the hood. A fast, spam-proof call mechanism, fine-tuned chimes, and a brand new, one-of-a-kind, patent-pending departure timer for maximum comfort. The highest expression of elegance and function in just 41. The new objective was to make the redstone footprint smaller, and the fault lies in the way the timer is built and placed. Apart from keeping it within the rail boundaries, there's really no excuse for this 3x7 block monstrosity, but all the inputs and outputs are perfectly aligned. How pretty. Furthermore, there are now two detector rails, one for the timer, the other for the go signal. If the bay is cleared just in time to accept the incoming cart, the window of vulnerability shrinks even more. So, one way to reduce the footprint is by squishing the middle part. And in this compact iteration, the bays have a single, well-defined point of entry, and the collector is split in two, next to a simplified loader. Having the modules close together leaves the side open for ramps and overhead pathways. The compact version is not as high-end as the flagship, but the improvements are noticeable, from 37 to 35 blocks of footprint against 41. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough. The safe area in the ravine station was only 27 blocks long, or a few more if I wanted to cram a mangled timer into the red zone. The detectors could have been shorter, but less effective, and removing the timer was out of the question. For one thing, the fact an incoming cart can cause so much trouble bothered me. I had to build a convoluted mess just to fight a rare inconvenience. And yet the requirements were always the same. A cart ready whenever possible, a timed departure, and a reliable collector and loader. No mention of the button, huh? What if there's no button to press? Alright, I get on the cart. Then what? Maybe I can walk through a gate attached to a monitoring station and through a series of advanced just a pressure plate. In this automatic iteration, the bay is powered by default. The pressure plate triggers a timer which will unpower the bay and send a short pulse to the dispenser. The player has a few seconds to get in the cart before it goes away. A cart from the previous station instead will send a go signal and trigger the same timer, while also temporarily disabling access to the dispenser, just enough time to let the blocking signal from the timer itself catch up. The fancy loader from the flagship is back, and you also get a view of the redstone. And what about its footprint? Only 29 blocks on the longest side. But it's not enough. Don't get me wrong. It works much better than before. It's just that I find the dedicated loaders a little too wasteful. So the second automatic iteration not only has a single loader, it's got a clever way to determine which dispenser gets the cart. Remember what I said about where hoppers keep the items they have received? They can also steal them from underneath, as long as the bottom one is unpowered. In this setup, the dispenser on the right pulls the loaded cards to itself when it's running low. It's not a perfect solution, but it works. And the redstone footprint is only 25 blocks on the longest side. You know what? Everything got improved, apart from the dispenser. There must be an easier way. Oh wait. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Externally, it works pretty much the same way as the previous two, but internally, everything changes. The dispenser is powered by two outputs from Hopper Barbara. When you request a cart, the timer unpowers both the rail and the dispenser at the same time. Then, after one redstone tick, only the dispenser is turned back on. When the timer expires, the rail is powered again and the cart moves forward. When a cart is approaching the station, one pulse triggers the timer and another powers the rail, which also keeps the dispenser activated, preventing it from spawning any new cart. It's also got a fancy indicator light that turns on when the cart is about to depart. It's incredible what a single timer can do. Nothing is wasted, nothing is redundant. I hope the previous 60 minutes or so were informative, as well as entertaining. You have no idea how much it means to me. There's a new video in the works, featuring 5 more designs. One of them, quite like the others. As always, these things take time. There should be a button somewhere that notifies people about new uploads. I can't seem to find it. Can you? Speaking of which, I did my due diligence after all and searched for any matching builds. Nothing came up. I'm sure you look hard enough. That's where you come in. Stick around for a few more minutes, and if you have any suggestions or improvements, let me know in the comments. I'll make a video about it. Thank you for watching.